What's up, fam? This is Anthony D. Mays with another edition of Mama Said Knock You Out. All right, no, but for real, I know I always talk about technical interviewing, but today I want to talk about something different. All anyone can talk about nowadays is vibe coding, MCP, LLMs, and AGI, and honestly, your boy's kind of getting tired of it. But I get it. Like, everybody suddenly thinks that they can have a multi-billion dollar SaaS company because we've got AI to do the coding for us, and I get it, right? But what about all the stuff they don't tell you about vibe coding? Hey, gather around, fam. Unc's got something to say. Before we get into this, let's talk about what vibe coding is, because it seems like everybody has a different definition of what it means. Technically, vibe coding is about using an LLM to write code for you to make something happen. And you don't really care about the code it produces, you just want the result. So you may not even understand the code, or you may not care, but the idea is that you use some LLM to go just write the code and build systems for you. And it's great, right? There are people who have had ideas for a long time, the thinkers who haven't been able to do the work, that are now able to like crank out apps. And that's fantastic. I really have a hard time using LLMs like that. Like, I don't, because I don't trust the vibes. I never do. I don't even trust people. When I actually say vibe coding, what I'm referring to is the ability to use LLMs more like a pair programmer. And I'm bringing the knowledge and experience while it's bringing the keystrokes. Over the past couple of months, I've been vibe coding an app called Mocker, which is designed for developer interview prep. And if that's something that's interesting to you, make sure that you get on the wait list and sign up because I'm gonna be launching this soon. So yay. Having almost 25 years of experience means that there are things that I intuitively understand about taking an application and turning that into a production service that some people may miss. And I wanna talk about those seven things here so that you can begin thinking about that if you're considering taking your vibe coded app and turning that into something that will eventually turn into a business or a startup or something of that nature. So walk with me as we go through this journey, and I'm just going to talk about these things in really no particular order. So the first thing that I want to talk about is scalability. It turns out that AI doesn't solve that for you automatically. Making something scalable and able to handle a large number of users or a large number of queries per second isn't something that an AI just automatically figures out. You have to know strategies for building scalable systems that are efficient, and you need to bring that knowledge to the LLMs so that they can build things the way that you want it. And you know, that's not easy. There are a lot of things that you have to consider. It's not just, do you do sharding, or do you go with microservices or monoliths, or you know, what's the caching strategy gonna be? But it's also about timing. When do you do those things? Many times when you're building an app, you just really wanna validate your ideas and you wanna figure out the product market fit before you start really thinking about scale. It's better to, when you have a low number of users, kind of figure things out and get feedback, and then later on think about throwing, you know, whatever you're gonna throw at it. When you're thinking about scalability, it's important to know the patterns and techniques that help you to build things at scale in a way that works. One other challenge that you need to be thinking about though is what happens if you get sudden bursts of usage? What if your app really does take off and you go from having, you know, tens of users to 1,000 users in several minutes? It can get really expensive using cloud providers and systems if you haven't thought about that beforehand and what your strategy is gonna be. So these are things that an LLM might not figure out that you need to do, that you definitely should be thinking about so that you avoid trouble and traps and really expensive cloud bills. Ask me how I know. Now, if you're hoping that your app is gonna make money, then obviously you need to be thinking about payments and payment integration. And it turns out that payments is a really hard problem. I've been using Stripe for my app and it's great. I love Stripe. It's well documented. There's a lot of great tools and features that it has. However, it still only makes a hard problem as easy as it can be. It doesn't make it easy. And you need to be thinking about what kind of payment flows you want to support. Are you doing subscriptions or not subscriptions? What about coupons? How do you build that into your app? What responsibility are you going to take versus what are you going to have the third party handle? Where do emails go? These are things that you need to be considering beforehand. And if you are hoping that an LLM is just going to be able to hook up your app to a Stripe integration like easily, maybe it will be able to, but in my experience, it was definitely not easy to do. It pays for you to get some experience working with payment APIs, and more importantly, just thinking through what the payment flow should be for your application so that your users have a great experience. And what happens if things fail, right? It's easy to think about the happy path and to use an LLM to get that all coded and working. But what happens when things fail? What happens when someone uses a bad credit card? What happens when a service endpoint acts up or you miss a message on your webhook? These are things that you need to be planning for and thinking about for robustness, correctness, and the reliability of your system. It's important for you to think about these things because the LLM might not be thinking about that at all. Many times it's just going to do the minimal amount of effort required to fulfill exactly what you've asked for with a little bit of gold plating, I've noticed. I'm talking about you, Claude. Now, speaking of payments, one other thing that I've noticed that, you know, LLMs have struggled with as I've been vibe coding is integration tests. Like, integration testing is just hard by itself, and it's hard for humans. It's also hard for LLMs. So you need to be thinking about what your integration test strategy is going to be. What are you going to write integration tests for first? What's going to come second? What's going to go on the back burner? I would not be comfortable supporting a production app without having the safety net that are integration tests. I don't push anything to production without ensuring that the integration tests are passing on the most critical workflows of the system so that I can avoid things like regressions, because regressions will leave a bad taste in your user's mouth and you'll seem incompetent at the end of the day. And I ain't nobody's fool. You feel me? So integration tests are important, but it can be difficult to figure. And I know that there are new tools like the Playwright MCP that hopefully will make this easier, and some other things. I'm personally using Cypress, which is great. But if you're not thinking about integration tests, nobody is. Think about that as part of your testing strategy, not just unit tests. Here's another thing that I spent a whole lot of time on, like almost way too much time. LLMs will not solve logging and analytics for you. When you are building your applications, you need to be thinking about observability. And that means that you need to be able to figure out what your application is doing at any given time, or what it's done in the past if users are running into issues or you notice anomalies in how things are going down. And you don't get that without observability. And so it's not just, you know, console logging stuff, right? It's also like routing that data to the right places. You know, if you've got a web application, that web application probably needs to talk server side to some API that will then collect logs and then send that somewhere else. And I guarantee you, you are not gonna vibe your way into Loki and Prometheus and metrics logging and stuff. It's just not gonna happen. You need to understand how those APIs work, how those systems work, and the philosophies around building observable and traceable systems, and then bring that knowledge to the LLM so that it does the things that you need it to do. I spent a lot of time trying to solve this problem, trying to figure out how to collect logs, what kind of information should be stored, what the abstractions need to be, how to collect all of that data and then send it to the right place, how to deal with batching, how to deal with filling in the gaps if some part of the logging breaks and backfilling. And then once you get the logs where you need it to be, you need to think about data storage and retention. You need to think about privacy and trust and safety. If the user doesn't consent to having their information tracked, you gotta make sure that you aren't sending data in the logs anymore. And then after that part, you've gotta figure out like how to read the data from the log so then track metrics that tell you that your system is healthy, or to figure out what your 7-day, 28-day, 14-day active usage is. So there's a lot of complexity there that, fortunately, because of my experience, I've had the opportunity to solve these kinds of problems in the past, and I know how to ask ChatGPT or Claude or Gemini how to do things that I needed to do in order to improve the observability and traceability and debuggability of my applications. But if you don't know about these things, you should learn those concepts so that you can ask the LLM to assist you in implementing those systems so that you'll be able to support your application when things get rough. And they will. Another big area for me has been in figuring out how to collect feedback from my users. And there's a lot of different kinds of feedback. There's product quality feedback and customer satisfaction surveys, but there's also like if something bad happens or doesn't go well, how do I get the user to provide enough information to me so that I can go and track that down? It's not just providing an email address. Sometimes you want to be able to do things like see a stack trace for an error or a screenshot, or to be able to replay events. There's a lot of things out there that can help you in terms of getting feedback from the user when things go wrong or when things go right. Your users want to be able to provide feature requests so that you can go and build out new functionality. You need that when you're validating a product and figuring out where you want to take it. So being able to provide those avenues are things that you should be thinking about. And as you are preparing your vibe-coded idea to become a productionized app, you need to think about the different pathways for feedback that you want to provide your users, whether that be good feedback or bad feedback. And for those of you that are building AI features into your app, you absolutely need to be able to collect feedback from your users about the quality of the AI responses they're getting. This is something that I figured out that I need to do in order to fine-tune and calibrate how I am prompting models for information that the users want. No LLM model is perfect. They can get you pretty far, but you're gonna have to make adjustments, and that needs to be a data-informed process. Think about how you are collecting feedback. What are the touch points that you need to have? How do you make sure that it's not too annoying? But then also, how do you make sure that you respect the user's privacy preferences and even legal and compliance things like GDPR or CCPA? As an experienced engineer, one thing that I have learned that has saved my butt on countless occasions is the ability to gate features using experiment flags. It is so easy to cause a regression in production when you're launching new features, especially when you're trying to launch features quickly and get that out the door. You can test on something locally and you can work through it and all this stuff. And then as soon as you put in production, it breaks people. Maybe it doesn't work the way that you thought it was gonna work, or maybe it doesn't work for your users the way you thought it would. And being able to turn off features or enable them quickly with things like phased rollout or percentage rollouts, or being able to select which users you enable that for is super important. If you don't know what experiment flags are, absolutely learn how to use them, how to build them, how to gate features in the right way so that as you're releasing new stuff, you have the ability to react quickly if that thing is going bad and you need to turn it off. Using experiment flags is something that I learned while being a software engineer at Google. And I tell you, ever since I've learned about it, I've not stopped using it. Like, for anything that I build, I try to make sure that if it is going to be something that is going to look different to the user or change their user experience, I want to have a feature flag ready to go so that if I need to turn that off, great. Or if I need to delay turning it on for until I'm comfortable that it really works well in production, I can do that. Here's the last thing that I'll mention. If you are allowing users to post anything or share anything, you need to have content moderation, and you need to be thinking about content moderation, because guess what? The LLM isn't going to do that for you. See, LLMs are super trusting. They trust you. They don't think you're gonna do anything bad, but I know you're gonna do something bad. You might believe in free speech, but I come from the land of say that again and watch what happens. I'm not building anything without having some levers for content moderation that help to ensure that I can react if people do or say bad things, which in my experience, they absolutely will. When you are building user like community features or feedback features or sharing features, you need to think about content moderation and how you're gonna deal with that. And the LLMs, again, aren't just going to suggest that you do that. Many companies that you know and love today have trust and safety departments that are concerned with making sure that the quality of the things that they produce and the quality of user interactions make their users feel safe, and that you feel like there's reliability there and that you're not doing bad things with people's data or making people have a bad time. Content moderation is just a part of that strategy. Now, there's a lot more that I can say about legal notices and disclosures, your email policy, security practices, and you name it. But I just felt like sharing these 7 things that really resonated with me as I have been working on this app for the past couple of months. And listen, I encourage you definitely to check it out. It's at mocker.ai. There's gonna be a link in the description. I've had a lot of fun building this and I've been learning a lot, and I wanna bring that knowledge to you. It's great to talk about technical interviewing, but life isn't all about technical interviewing. You can be a sucker if you want to and rely on preparing for technical interviews that you're never going to get because you didn't actually think about your resume and how you prepare your portfolio. Or you can use these tools to get busy actually building things that people can use and that are valuable, and then using those things that you build to talk about what you actually can do and not what you would do if you were given a shot. Don't just spend all your time doing technical interviews. Spend some time building things. Matter of fact, you should probably spend more time building things than you do practicing on leak code. Can I be honest? All right, y'all, that was enough for me. I hope that you enjoyed this video. Leave a like, leave a comment. Let me know how I can make this better. I want to engage with you. Y'all know how I am. And in the meantime, y'all keep it classy. Peace.